ever seen Nelly on my arm, a soft hand rested, rested light as ocean foam, and was from Aunt Dinah's quilting party. I was seeing Nelly home.
I was seeing Nelly home.
Home. I was seeing Nelly home. And was from Aunt Dinah's quilting party. I was seeing Nelly lips a whisper tremble, tremble till it dared to come. And was from Aunt Dinah's quilting party. I was seeing Nelly home.
I was seeing Nelly home.
Home. I was seeing Nelly home.
And was from Aunt Dinah's quilting party. I was seeing Nelly home.
Hi.
Hi.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to the last quilt documentation day for the month of I'm hoping Amanda is We did an audition or a tryout this morning, and I didn't have this reverb problem, so I'm not sure why we're having it now, but give me a second that we can maybe figure this out. Okay, I'm supposed to log out and log back in, so I will do that. Excuse me for a minute. Be right back. Good morning. Okay, we're live now again. Okay, I hope you all who are joining us this morning got to hear a little bit of Aunt Dinah's Quilting Party song, because I thought that was a really fun way perhaps to introduce what we'll be talking about today. That song was actually written in the 1850s, which by the 1850s, people were nostalgic for old-time quilting parties, and I think that song was part of that nostalgia. And then in 1901, there was a woman who created a play in one scene called Aunt Jerusha's Quilting Party that I think was later also called Aunt Dinah's Quilting Party. And she kind of elaborated on this nostalgia and kind of took it to task, I think, really. You know, in 1901, this Aunt Dinah's Quilting Party play, which would be played in communities here in South Carolina in the 1920s and 1930s. You could go in December. Often there was this at the schools, local schools, there would be a performance of Aunt Dinah's or Aunt Jerusha's Quilting Party, a scene in one, or an entertainment in one scene, I think is how it was described. So, oh, hey, Judy and Drusilla, great to have you back. Good to see you joining us today. Because I think you'll be interested in some of the connections I'll be able to make today with what we're discussing and some of the previous programs that we've had. So good to see you all. So Aunt Dinah's Quilting Party, again, nostalgic in 1850. In 1901, a woman writes this one-act play, essentially, that kind of expands on this or is a reaction to this nostalgic song. Written by a man, and she, you know, again, it's a lot of dialogue and also some songs in this one-act play that addresses the woman's question and a lot of other things related to quilting culture. So, it's pretty fun. And then again, enjoys a revival in the 20s and 30s, which I guess the case I want to make today is that nostalgia comes back, or it survives and comes back, because by 1920s, 30s. Women's roles have expanded considerably in the United States, all across the United States. And part of what we'll be talking about today is how quilts figured in that expanded woman's role. So so I'm going to ask you to indulge me a little bit today, because I am a little bit still in the weeds of the research I was doing on quilts in December. I decided that it would be fun just to see what quilts and quilt makers were doing in the month of December in years prior. So I took a look at that, and what I found was a little overwhelming, because a lot was going on with quilts in December. I think what surprised me most was how many organizations, women's organizations, were making quilts, selling quilts, exhibiting quilts, presenting quilts. There were just all kinds of quilt related events happening in the month of December, and they were being organized a lot by the Ladies Aid Societies, which, again, I don't know a lot about the history of that organization or those organizations, but they were founded during the Civil War. So women in the North and the South during the Civil War organized relief efforts on behalf of the soldiers they were trying to support. And even in the northern states, African-American women often joined with Euro-American women in these ladies' aid societies to collect supplies and get them to their soldiers in need. Later on during the war, those African-American women actually often formed their own societies specifically to help the regiments that were composed of African-Americans. So ladies' aid societies were sort of the beginning of it all, it seems to me. But then the Deborah Society within the Jewish community was formed in the 19th century, again, for Jewish women to help create a place, a space for Jewish women to engage in community service, philanthropy. You have quilts involved. So Rebekah lodges are using quilts to raise money for their efforts. You have the Women's Christian Temperance Union is actually making quilts to support their efforts. You have the Women's Relief Corps, which was a branch of the Grand Army of the Republic, which was an organization, again, formed after the Civil War to provide relief to soldiers, veterans, and their families. You have the Daughters of the Confederacy forming in the South, which they were using quilts to raise money, often for monuments in the wake of the Civil War, and also veterans' benefits. You also have, at a more local level, you have homemakers clubs, you have good neighbor clubs, you have any number of clubs that women organized, and quilts figured in the December efforts to, again, encourage friendly competition, make presentation gifts and awards to members of their society, but also members in their community, and many other kinds of efforts. So So what they had, the kinds of events, I mean, there was the perennial Ladies Aid Apron and Quilt Bazaar for sale. So, and those happened anywhere from, you know, church basements to, in some communities, they would host these bazaars or sales in a department store or a local business. They didn't have department stores, but in a local business. And then there were also raffles where 10 cents would get you your name on a quilt. There were expositions, fairs, contests. And then the last thing I'll talk about today is the Christmas box tradition, which many of you may already know about that, but I was pretty clueless. It's a kind of adaptation of the British Boxing Day tradition, but it seems to have survived in South Carolina, particularly in the upstate, in a way all on its own. So if you were 150 years ago, if you were a quilt maker, what might you be doing in December? And I thought, okay, I'll start big in terms of the sort of broader quilt-related activities you might have been involved in December, and get to the more personal kinds of activities that women might have, that you might have joined in or initiated yourself in December in years past. So this image here of and a Judy Twitty, I thought about you here, and when I saw this. So we tend to think of quilt, or at least I had tended to think of quilt festivals, big exhibitions being associated with the revival in the latter part of the 20th century. Well, here we have, the Dime Museum in Memphis, Tennessee. There's Crosby's Mammoth Dime Museum Palace, decided in December of 85, that they were going to host a all crazy, crazy quilt exposition. Next image, please. Hi, Amanda. Can we switch to the next image? Yeah. So when I saw this, I was just a little surprised, but I guess I shouldn't have been. But there were all kinds of other. The Dime Museum offered all kinds of entertainments. Among them, the floating half lady. They actually had a lot of other kinds of competitive events. Next image, please. So here you have the fast typesetting contest. So again, the great crazy quilt exposition seems to have been designed to appeal to a particular group of women in the Southeast, because again, women from Virginia, from Mississippi, maybe even South Carolina, submitted crazy quilts to this exhibition. And it was announced as the social triumph of the amusement circles. And the one of the observers said, mind you, I'm sorry, take it back here a second, but when I was looking at all the different kinds of acts, and again, they were trying to get participatory kind of acts that would really engage people and get people in the community locally, but also beyond, involved, right? Because chances are then their friends and family would pay the dime to come to their museum. So there was this, there was actually a fat woman's convention where they put out a call for large ladies who might want to come and be part of a fat woman's, So again, the political incorrectness associated with Crosby's Mammoth Dime Museum was pretty intense. You have midgets, you have, half ladies, you've got the snake women, but here you have also this call for crazy quilts. Let's see here. And to incentivize this, can you show the next image, Amanda? Yeah, they had prizes. So this is Lowenstein's store, so quite the palace, right? And they were exhibiting the silver coffee urn, the silver tea service, and a lady's diamond ring of the most elegant order, sufficient to induce any lady possessing a quilt to enter it in the exposition. position. So, and the women who were thinking about participating in this clearly made their concerns known, because as the advertisements and enticements for this quilt, crazy quilt exposition were published, the organizers made sure to note that they were building special boxes, huge lock boxes, to keep the quilt safe at night, and a watchman sleeps in the building on each floor. They were devoting, they ended up devoting two large floors to over 100 crazy quilts that were submitted. So that they were trying to assure the women they were taking the best care for this this quilt. Let's see here. So the exposition gave great public recognition of the crazy quilt as art, which I thought was pretty interesting. Quote, "The art of making one is an art as distinctive as creating a bit of Queen Anne's tapestry, as it requires decorative skill and unquestioned artistic judgment in blending colors, and otherwise the brightness of some or the dullness of other in coloring failed to catch the eye. It was thought that the crazy quilt had died away until W.E. Crosby and his manager, Mr. Buckley, planned and successfully inaugurated this exhibition of crazy patchwork. And then the fact was suddenly developed that many ladies were still working zealously at quilts of this style. And in fact, many hardly finished some of their crazy quilts in time for the exhibition. And plenty of ladies called to see when the exposition was to be opened, as they wanted to line or finish their quilts. Judy Twitty, I thought of you and the Aiken Historical Society exhibit and trying to get your quilt in. And again, one of the writers describing this event said it's oddly inferred that only ladies, young and middle-aged ones at that, work at these crazy quilts. But several young men have entered into the competition with the ladies. Number 82 quilt was made by a young boy and had two bolsters attached. They also had a steamership captain submit a baby quilt that had come down in his family. And one member of a community in Virginia submitted a 92-year-old quilt made by Mrs. Lucy Roberts. And this was submitted by her grandson, sent to Memphis, Tennessee. The finest crazy quilt of the exhibition was described as having a central block made from pieces of the pontifical robes of the late Cardinal McCloskey, while other blocks contained pieces from the gowns worn by members of the royal family of England. It had 201 different stitch styles. Now, on the third day of the exposition, voting was so heavy that over 2,000 votes being cast that the management fell far behind on the counting. But you know, they kind of listed out the ones, the numbers of the quilts that were getting the most votes at that point in time. And included in that was the quilt by the young boy that had the bolsters attached, but also a Masonic emblem quilt that was owned by Mrs. Wagoner of Brownsville, Tennessee. And that one was to be raffled off after the exposition. You know, for what purpose, I have not yet been able to determine, but you have just seen scrolled through some crazy quilts that I found on the Quilt Index, having been made in Tennessee from the historical period that this exposition was in, and what may have been part of this crazy quilt exposition in Memphis, Tennessee. Okay, so next event, in 1889, there was a centennial quilt project organized by the Congregational Church of Spokane, Washington, that was a fundraiser for a building fund. So this is their original church, which was wooden framed. And the church was founded with a certain degree of openness, or committed to a certain degree of openness. It was founded at a mission that the church had had founded to serve the Spokane Indian tribe. And two of the eight founding members of this church were reportedly members of the Spokane Indian tribe. The church still exists. Okay, so this is a historical image of members of the Spokane Indian tribe. And the church, when I contacted them to find out more about whether that relationship between the Spokane Indians and the church had continued, They sadly told me no, that it had not, and that they were working to really understand this history better. They knew nothing about this centennial quilt that was apparently very effective at raising money to replace their original church, which had burned in the Great Fire of 1889 in Spokane. It was a devastating fire. It burned buildings on several blocks in the downtown area. And the women of this church put a call out to the governors across the United States. They were trying to represent all the governors, and they were soliciting blocks from each state that would have the governor's and his wife, if he was married's name, on the quilt. And interestingly enough, they also claimed to have reached out to Fisk University's Indian Department to get a block that would represent the Indian territories in recognition of their founding principles and their origination as part of an Indian mission. I contacted Fisk University because I was very interested in learning more about their Indian Department. And the special collections librarian sent me the catalogs, the class catalog, course catalogs from 1888 and 1889. And there does not seem to be an Indian Department. So I'm still working on that. But I thought from the point of view of the organizers, there was at least an effort to try to be somewhat inclusive in their thinking about how they were raising money. And it sort of was, I guess, the early day precedent of sort of nationwide effort, relief effort to help rebuild a community that had been devastated by a disaster like a fire. Next image. So the quilt, the centennial quilt was a centennial garrison, Harrison quilt. They were getting his and his wife's signatures as well. And they had, I don't know what that quilt looked like. So I pulled images of garrison memorabilia on fabric. This was like a handkerchief size kind of portrait piece that women quilters could have used as a central medallion in a centennial quilt. Next image. This was also a centennial quilt in honor of George Washington and Benjamin Harrison. That was celebrating 100 years of our nation. So the women at the Congregational Church in Spokane were invoking this 100 years of history of the United States in order to, again, solicit support from the governors of each state, the Indian territories, to raise funds to address what, from their point of view, was a national disaster in their community. Keep going. So they were successful. So by 1890, this was the stone church that replaced the wooden structure that had burned down. So to what extent the fundraiser from the the quilt, how much of those funds they raised, how much of that was what they needed to build this new church, It clearly was some part of that, and I can hopefully find out more in the future. But I just thought it was really interesting that, again, women all over the country were sending blocks to support this effort of a centennial quilt for a building fund. Next image. So in 1901, again, quilt raffles. Raffles were really, really very much a way, and I know contemporary quilt guilds use raffles to raise money for their guilds activities. When I went to the greater, Quilters of South Carolina's spring event a couple years ago, I think there were 8 to 10 raffle quilts on exhibition, and I bought tickets for all of them because they were so beautiful. They were usually a dollar each or $6 for $5. And in this case, it was dimes, right? So people usually would get a chance for a dime. And it made me wonder if perhaps the raffle quilt was the business model for, or inspired the business model for the dime museum, since a dime seemed to be what most people could afford to spend out of their disposable income. But again, this particular autograph quilt was being donated. It was raffled off once. And again, this was a strategy that was often used. So when you were trying to create something to benefit a particular cause, and again, in this case, it was the Grant Relief Corps, which is was the Women's Relief Corps that had been created after the Civil War as a women's auxiliary for the Grand Army of the Republic. Again, initially, they were raising money for veterans and their families as to support them. You know, often the men were wounded and could not return to their jobs. And so that was what that organization originally was doing. But by the time this autograph quilt is being raffled again, it took them 5 years to create this quilt. But by the time it's being raffled again, the Women's Relief Corps were involved with a lot of other issues. They were promoting maternity care. They were involved with, you know, child labor laws. They were involved in women's suffrage and immigration law. So their mission had creeped far beyond supporting veterans and their families by the early 20th century. And these are examples, again, of autograph quilts that may have looked like what they created. The description of the quilt in this particular article was that there were red signatures on muslin blocks, and these quilts fit that bill, and they are from different parts of the country. Again, the quilt index was a great resource for me to find quilts that were signature quilts, autograph quilts that might have been similar to what was created there in 1901. The next effort I wanted to talk about was in 1917. The United Daughters of the Confederacy in Arizona, believe it or not, had a quilt on display in the Home Economics Department of a fair, which will be auctioned off at a bazaar in December for the benefit of a French war orphan. The quilt was made by Mrs. Satterwhite Adams of Quincy, Illinois, who's a winter resident in Arizona. So I was very surprised. I didn't realize there were chapters of the United Daughters of the Confederacy as far away as Arizona. And this is, again, there was no image of this quilt, but this would have been a 19th century example of a UDC quilt. Can you show the detail, please? Obviously very faded, but this is, a signature made by the fifth, hard to read, town, regiment, chapter, UDC. I can't read the embroidery here. Some of you may be better able to do that. Okay, I'm looking here. What was the date of the contest? If you can let me know which contest you're interested in knowing. I think it was 1885 was the contest in Memphis, Tennessee, in conjunction with the Crazy Quilt Exposition. If there's a different contest you want dates, I can look back in my notes and find that. But thank you for asking. Okay, next image, please. These are just images of 19th century UDC quilts. This one was never quilted. It was a top. This is beautiful signature embroidered by someone from Memphis. Again, a lot of these quilts were done in red and white or blue and white, so that the muslin, you know, you would embroider the names of people as part of the fundraiser. And this, I thought this was just fascinating. This is the Eastern Order of Star, the fraternal organization. They, again, were one of the many organizations that were using quilts to raise money and to document their own history. Next image. Okay, so quilt embroidered by Mrs. Coolidge brings $25 at a sale. Again, so women were very resourceful quilters at finding a hook for what would help sell their quilts. And the Coolidges had vacationed in South Dakota one summer, and someone, a member of the Congregational Church, where they had attended services, got their embroidered signature of Mrs. Coolidge, and it was used to help raise money for their church. Next image. This is a little out of order because in truth, you know, I showed you the images of the UDC signature quilts, the United Daughters of the Confederacy, but by the time they were having their fundraiser to help French orphans, this is the kind of quilt that, this is a 20s, 30s quilt. So we're into the more Depression era color wave. So you can see how in the latter part of the 19th, early part of the 20th century, you have the red and blue, red and white, blue and white quilts with the signatures on it. In the 20s and 30s, you begin to get the more Depression era colors. Next image. So these are all signature quilts from that latter period. So you can't see the signatures on this, but they are there. Next image. Yeah. Okay, so in 1939, the Tabor Presbyterian Colored Church in Washington, D.C., had a quilt contest. So I just thought, you know, there isn't a lot in the newspapers about the activities of African-American women. So when I found this, I just thought it was important to know that African-American women were active quilting. And in 1939, they were celebrating, this particular congregation was celebrating its 15th anniversary. And they decided to have a quilt contest and bazaar. So African-American congregations, they don't say that there was a ladies' aid society specifically here, but African-American churches were the women in those churches were doing much what the Euro-American women were doing in ladies' aid societies throughout the country in having these quilt bazaars. You know, I don't know if they had aprons too, but the apron and quilt sales bazaars were prolific, and African-American women were participating in that kind of tradition as well in December. Next image. Okay, so I'm going to bring you to the 1950s. So by the 1950s, you know, I just thought this was quite lovely. Look how small the waist is of that one particular woman on the left. I'm sure I would be wearing the one on the right just for comfort. But yeah, by 1950, and that's 70 years ago, not a lot of quilt making was going on, but some. A little bit was. I mean, there was a lot of ads again about taffeta quilted bedrobes, and you get that actually for quite a number of decades in the newspapers advertising quilted bathrobes. So quilting as part of garments goes in and out of fashion throughout really the latter part of the 19th century into, you know, the 1950s. On and off, it becomes fashionable to have capes that have interior silk, quilted silk in them. Skirts, and then bathrobes. Next image, please. So this is a quilt from a Rebekah Lodge in the 1950s. So these organizations that were founded in the 19th century by women continued on and continue on till to this day. And I just thought you might want to see a little snippet. This was clearly a very simple kind of pattern with the outline of the black outline embroidery, but talked about the conductor in here. You know, it's a detail, A. Gregory Lodge mother. It was one of the few examples that I could find of a quilt made by a Rebekah Lodge, but it would have been, raffled off, auctioned off. It probably would have been a fundraiser for their efforts in the 1950s. Next image. Again, I couldn't help but put this image of Mrs. Elizabeth C. Lilly, who celebrated her 98th birthday on Saturday, on the day preceding her birthday, finished piecing a quilt, which she began in December. So again, the place that December seems to have played in quilt makers' lives was pretty well acknowledged in the newspapers. I mean, I love it that women who were quite ambitious and were known for making lots of quilts were publicly recognized in the newspapers. And almost always the comment was, they have done this since Christmas, or have made this many quilts December. And this is one southern example I found from Fort Valley, Georgia. It says, other towns in Georgia should have more young ladies like Miss Leela Finney. Since she was 6 years old, she has made or pieced up 593 quilts. Since Christmas, again, she has pieced up a quilt containing 4,438 pieces. This and considerable housework have been done under sore afflictions, as Miss Leela is not a healthy girl and deserves great credit for what she has accomplished. We have also a Mrs. Julia Miller, is 75 years old, has pieced 4 bed quilts and a silk spread since December 15th. Besides caring for her own home, she walks half a mile to her mailbox and back every afternoon. So quilters who were prolific, ambitious, known for making quilts in their community, older women, clearly a younger woman who had some kind of disability, they were called out in their communities for having made quilts, for how many quilts they'd made and how many pieces were in that quilt since December. So it seemed like December really was an important month in the rhythm of a quilt maker's life. It was sort of when there was kind of a culmination of the exhibits, the sales that you had worked the previous year to make possible. And then after December, you'd start on the piecing for the next year. And that was a kind of important rhythm of the year. Next. So again, by the 1960s, there's not a whole lot about quilting in the newspapers, but this was put as kind of a children's coloring image, which it's linked as if it's a patchwork grandma's quilt pattern. And I just thought for those of you who do make quilts, it might be fun to actually adapt this as a quilt block for Christmas holidays. And if you want to know, when this appeared, I think it was 1963, but I can put that on Facebook so that if you want to find it and try your hand at making it, it looks like it'd be kind of hard to create the pattern for it, but there's so many creative ways to do that these days in terms of templates and applique using glue sticks. I just thought that this was kind of a fun image to share. But yeah, by the 1960s, grandma's quilting patterns are used to create coloring pages for children in the newspapers. Next image. So here we are, we're back at Dinah's quilting party. And again, I thought I would go to the play and that I mentioned earlier, that was written by Laura M. Parsons in 1901. And she at one point in the play, towards the end of the play, she writes, you might as well attempt to lock up the winds or chain the fury of the waves as to expect to get into a sewing society or a quilting party and not have some joke played on you. I think that suggests that quilters were having fun. That was a lot of what quilt making was about. I think Mrs. Julia D. Rankin, or not Rankin, Shanklin, and she lived in Bounty Land, Oconee County, South Carolina, is an example of that kind of woman who would have had that kind of quilting party. I'm going to close with her story because I find it such so wonderfully complicated. Let's put it that way. So Mrs. Julia D. Ranklin, Shanklin, I'm sorry, S-H-A-N-K-L-I-N, she married a man who was a South Carolina College alum. So again, there's this direct connection to the University of South Carolina, which was kind of intriguing. He fought in the Civil War very bravely. And she married him after the war. So he was a Civil War veteran, and she gave birth to 4 sons. She was known in her community for making a particular kind of cake. She would always win in the county fair for her cakes. She was written up in the newspaper at one point in her older years for hosting a party of grandmothers. But the little blurb that kind of caught my attention was, one year she was, and I think it was like 11. She was putting together a Christmas box, and she invited members of her community to come to her house for a quilting party. And it turns out it was not a great day weather-wise, and a lot of people didn't show up, so the attendance was not so big. But it got me interested in her story and the story of the Christmas box. And it turns out, and again, many of you may already know about the tradition of Boxing Day in England, but it looks like in North America that was adapted by many women for things called a Christmas box. So in England, Boxing Day was the day that that people who had put coins in a box at the church, as part of their gift giving on the holidays, that the church would open those boxes and distribute the money to the poor. In more wealthy families, the Christmas box took the form of, if you had servants, you would put together a Christmas box that you would give them to thank them for their service for the year. And it would include, food, clothing, any number of kinds of things. But it was to thank people who had been in roles of service. And I think what's interesting in the United States is that, at least in the case of Mrs. Evidence that I found in South Carolina, was that the clergy, pastors were regarded as people you would thank at the holiday season. And quilts were often part, it was the presentation of a quilt to a pastor and his wife that was a big part of December quilt celebrations. Some women were very subtle about it in creating their Christmas box and would give it to the pastor, and then the pastor would thank them publicly in the newspaper for their Christmas box, which included a quilt. But in one case, the women of the church actually hung a quilt behind where the pastor would have been standing to give his Christmas sermon. And it was a big surprise. They did this on their own. So they were not shy about what they were doing to recognize their pastor and his wife. So again, the story of Mrs. Shanklin, her husband passed away in 1907, I believe. And she later founded a home missionary society. So it was really, I want to say it was like coming full circle for me with the research I've been doing this year on quilts here in South Carolina, because a year ago when I started doing research and I was looking specifically in some cases for evidence of African-American quilting traditions, I found an article in the Kiowee News from 1917, and it recognized Emily Mays, an African-American woman who donated a quilt to a relief package that was being organized in the upstate to send to Poland. Okay, I'm from Poland, or my dad's from Poland. So it really kind of caught my eye and tickled my fancy that women in upstate South Carolina were actually putting relief packages together after World War I, to send to Poland. And in this article in the Kiwi News, Emily Mays is called out by name, which is not very often. African-American women, if they are referred to, are typically just referred to as an African-American woman or a colored woman in that historical period as colored. But in this case, the writer of the article called out Emily Mays, and I remembered that. When I was doing research on Mrs. Shanklin and realized that, her home missionary society, that was the society that organized the relief for Poland. And it also organized relief for starving Chinese folks after that. So Mrs. Ranklin, was very involved with this effort. And when I went back and checked the earlier research I had done, sure enough, Mrs. Ranklin had been the woman to call out Emily Mays and thank her for her contribution to the box that they were sending to Poland in recognition of the fact that Emily Mays had lost a son in World War I, and that empathy that she felt towards the suffering of the families in Poland had inspired her to contribute this quilt to this relief box. And I just thought, again, you know, people are so wonderfully complicated. You know, other tidbits about Mrs. Shanklin's life, you can read, you know, when she visited her son in Anderson, the newspaper always made note of it. And so she went there for things like the Chautauqua, you know, so for these sort of public educational opportunities, she would go to visit her son and participate in the Chautauqua. But she also was noted in the newspaper as being especially excited to be going to see the premiere screening of A Birth of the Nation. You know, so so you go, oh, okay, so Birth of the Nation, that was really a very landmark film for revisiting the Civil War and the legitimacy of the rebel cause. I'm convinced that by the time you know, Mrs. Ranklin was in her later years and involved with philanthropy efforts, not just in her own community with a Christmas box that would have been given likely to her pastor or a pastor in the community to thank them for their service, but also with international relief efforts and acknowledging the contributions of other women. I think once she became very active in, or she founded and then was very active in a woman's organization, she was very generous in recognizing other women who had made a difference in the community. In addition to Emily Mays, there was a young woman who was very involved with raising money to support schools and education in the upstate of South Carolina. And she died very young, 37 years old. And Mrs. Ranklin took up the baton on behalf of creating a memorial for this young woman's gravesite that would recognize all that she had done to benefit the educational system in their community. So, Mrs. Ranklin, again, complicated, interesting woman, like many quilt makers, and again, very much a mover shaker in her community. And for those of you who participated in November's Quilt Appreciation Day, where we talked about Native American quilt making traditions, and Elsie Goen's grandmother, who lived in the same, pretty much the same community that that Mrs. Ranklin lived in. And in fact, I haven't had a chance to go back and check this research, but one of Mrs. Ranklin's sons was a commandant at Clemson College, university. And that's where Elsie Goen's grandmother had worked before she moved to Asheville. And my guess is that these women would have known each other in some capacity because of their interest in quilts and because these communities just were not that big, and they may have actually, you know, crossed paths at some point in their lives. So again, thank you for joining me today. It is now, 10 minutes to noontime. And I guess I wanted to thank, also the South Carolina Arts Commission for their support of folk life and traditional arts at the McKissick Museum. I want to thank Amanda Ballou, you know, our communications manager, who is my tech support and does a great job at that and helps us troubleshoot these problems we have. And then I want to thank those of you who really have already stepped up and responded to our call for help for quilt supplies, quilt collection storage supplies, because since COVID has sort of shifted our attention away from in-person exhibitions to online exhibitions and programs, we also paid a lot of attention to our collection storage capacity, and we're fortunate to get a grant to do an assessment, a formal outside assessment of our collections practices. And we realized, because we've been working with our quilts so much last year to do the quilt exhibit here at the museum from our collection, that the dowels that were used over 20 years ago, they were bought to roll our quilts on. There was a system built by one of the one of our former staff members' husbands, built a quilt storage rack system in our collection storage area. And the dowels, the long 9.5-foot dowels that were used to wrap the quilts on, roll the quilts on, which is the most responsible way you can store a quilt to prevent the creasing and to preserve it. Those dowels have become sort of sunken. And so this past year, we were able to replace 10 out of the, I think, 72 of them. And so for our end of the year fund drive through Giving Tuesday on Giving Tuesday in December, we were able to raise about $1,200 towards buying additional dowels. They are $50 a piece. And then in order to prep those dowels, what we'll have to do is to wrap polyester batting around them to cushion, you know, the quilt. So people made donations of $20 for a bat of polyester bat that we can use to wrap the dowels, and people made donations of $50 so we can actually get one of the dowels. So I want to thank all of you who've already donated, because that was a really, really big help to us. And if any of you are inspired or so inclined to still make a donation, Amanda will put a link in our Facebook sidebar there, that you can still go to the Midlands Gives, the Community Foundation link to our Giving Tuesday campaign, and still make a donation to that if you're so inclined before the end of this year. But you know, we're really dedicated to taking care and doing our due diligence as a museum to properly steward these quilts in our collection, because I think, at least, you know, again, I'm totally prejudiced here, but I really believe that the stories about women's history that these quilts enable us to tell, apart from the fact that they are a distinctive, you know, form of art, I think that women, especially in North America, took to great heights in a way that women in other countries didn't have the ability to do or didn't choose to do, that it's important, I guess, is what I'm saying. That I really believe the quilts and the stories that they enable us to tell about women and women's history and women's roles in history and their agency and efforts on behalf of their communities, the nation, their families, that these are important stories that wouldn't otherwise be told. Anybody have any questions about anything that I've talked about today? Because again, I've been, like I said, in the weeds of all of this information about raffles and apron and quilt bazaars and contests and these depictions of women who, again, since December or since Christmas have been so productive as evidence of just how what valued members of the community they were. And I think that's what the newspapers, the historical newspapers I've been looking at suggest, just how these women were valued members of their communities, and their quilt making made them stand out in some sense. So I hope that that Quilt Documentation Days in 2020 have been as inspiring for you as they have been for me, because again, they were an opportunity for me to do some primary research that I hadn't really undertaken in quite a while. And the internet has really made that kind of research expand, let's just put it that way. I was telling Amanda this morning before our program, I am able to get, I feel like I am living sometimes in upstate South Carolina, that I'm getting to know these communities. Because I'm able to make connections between the people in the communities and where they go to church, you know, who they visit. You just begin to get a real sense of the kind of communities people lived in. And that's kind of fun. So Drusilla, Judy, oh, they say thank you. Well, thank you all again for being part of this conversation. And if any of you have some observations about what December has meant, I know Judy Twitty, you had a couple projects on your lap. Do you want to talk a little bit about that or mention that in the chat there? Yeah, I'm looking forward to, we'll have a winter break here in a week or so. And I'm looking at the fabric at my house and thinking that maybe I can actually do something and be part of, again, this history, this culture, and this art form. So again, thank you all who've been a part of this series this past year in 2020. I think we're still trying to figure out whether we will continue doing this digitally in 2021, or perhaps, COVID permitting, actually return to doing something in person. So stay tuned. We are planning, put it in pencil, but we are planning on the evening of Thursday, January 28th, to reopen with two exhibits here. We will open the last version of the piece by piece exhibit of quilts from our permanent collection that folks have never gotten to see. And we will open an exhibit called Child's Play about toys. We thought that, one of our graduate assistants in the Museum Management Certificate Program sort of took up this idea of an exhibit based on the toys in the museum's collection. And that's kind of grown now. And we all felt that that having something playful for the new year, given how hard a year 2020 has been for many folks, would not be a bad idea. So pencil it on your calendars and know that we will have timed ticketing just to make sure that this is absolutely safe as an event. And there will be limited admission, unfortunately. But make your reservation through Eventbrite. We'll be putting out a link so that folks can reserve a time to come, and you'll be getting a guided tour of these two exhibitions if you decide to come to our opening on January 28th. So until then, be safe, have a wonderful holiday season, and I look forward to seeing you all hopefully in person sometime in 2021. Take care.